Welcome back. This is Darmadi Komo, your host for today. With me, I have Luis Carlos from engineering. Luis, tell us who you are and then what are you going to talk about today?
Sure. Thanks, Darmadi. So my name is Luis Vargas. I'm a program manager on the SQL Server High Availability team. So for the past almost four years, I've been working on AlwaysOn, the next generation of high availability and disaster recovery technologies in SQL Server. So today we're going to be talking about AlwaysOn enhancements on SQL Server 2014.
Okay, so before we do that, can you take us back to SQL Server 2012 and refresh
Sure.
our memory?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So looking back at SQL Server 2012, so when we started the release and we look at how do we define mission critical availability, we defined four dimensions that we wanted to achieve. We wanted the product to be reliable. What that means is we want to be able to detect failures reliably. We don't want false positives, for example. We don't want false negatives. We want to make sure that we only detect failures when they are really failures. We want to be able to stand multiple failures. So there can be failures, for example, in network. There can be failures in the physical machine. There could even be failures, for example, related to out-of-memory exceptions and other things that can affect SQL Server. So we want to be able to stand multiple of these failures happening even in parallel. We want to make sure that we have an integrated solution. So we want a single solution to handle high availability as well as disaster recovery. So in the past, you probably have used different technologies to achieve high availability and disaster recovery. You may have used database mirroring. You may have used log shipping, and maybe even SQL Server clusters. In SQL Server 2012, we wanted to unify all of these solutions and have a single solution that you configure, you manage, and you monitor. We also wanted this solution to be flexible. We know that many of our customers already have heavily invested in shared storage solutions like SANS, for example, and we wanted these customers to be able to reuse these environments. At the same time, we wanted to make sure that customers who have only direct attached disks were able to use the solution. Finally, we wanted to make sure that solution is efficient. We know that many of our customers are spending significant amounts of money in the high availability hardware. So many of them are having multiple secondary replicas, for example. I want to make sure that those replicas can be used for something else than just waiting for a failover to happen. Finally, we wanted to make sure that from the moment that we detect a failure to the moment that an application can connect and can continue running, it takes very little time. And we also wanted to make sure that applications do not need to change any logic of how they reconnect to the primary after a failover. So those were the four dimensions that we look into SQL 2012. Now, in SQL Server 2012, we introduced the term always on. Always on is a term that we use to refer to the set of high availability and disaster recovery technologies that we offer in SQL Server. We have two technologies at this point in time. One is failover cluster instances. And failover cluster instances is a solution that provides high availability for the SQL Server instance. This is a solution that we have had in the past since SQL Server 2000. And we introduced a new solution called availability groups. And availability groups provide high availability for groups of databases. So let's go into each of these. So as I mentioned, failover cluster instances is a pre-existing solution. It provides failover for the SQL Server instance. Very useful in consolidation scenarios where you have hundreds of databases and you want to make sure that all of these databases fail over at the same time, right? Very useful, for example, also if you have a large number of dependencies living outside of your database, for example, things like agent jobs or link servers, and you want to make sure that all of those dependencies fail over together with all the databases when there is a failure. SQL Server clusters are based on shared storage, and that means that they require either having a SAN or an SMB shared folder. So actually, since SQL Server 2012, we started supporting SMB shares as shared storage for SQL clusters. Again, failover cluster instances take a dependency on the shared storage, providing redundancy for the storage. So SQL Server clusters will not protect, for example, from failures that happen at the storage level. There is some assumption that the storage layer will provide redundancy. Failover takes minutes. So how many minutes? This can go from 1 to 3 minutes. This exactly is a little bit hard to tell because this will depend on the specific customer scenario. So the way it works with SQL clusters is if there is a failure, we detect that failure in the system, and we restart another SQL Server instance in another physical machine. That restart means that all the databases in that SQL Server need to go through a recovery process. So there will be some transactions, for example, that need to be committed and applied to disk, and there will be some transactions that may need to be rolled back. The number of transactions that need to be committed and rolled back at that point in time will determine how long it takes to recover those databases and how long the failover process will take. And we'll talk about some of the enhancements that we did in SQL 2012 to reduce those times. Again, SQL Server clusters is based on multiple nodes, so you can have multiple physical machines. And each of these machines can host its own SQL Server. However, only one of those nodes will be active at a time, right? The rest of the nodes will be passive. That means that you can only read or write data from one of the nodes. Now, the new solution that we introduced is called availability groups. It provides multi-database failover, and this means that you can put multiple databases within the same availability group, and all of these databases will fail over together in case that there is a failure. So this means, for example, if you lose connectivity to the primary replica that is hosting your databases for your applications, we'll fail over all of those databases into another replica. That replica, it's going to be another SQL Server that doesn't require access to any shared storage. With availability groups, each of the replicas can simply have their own direct attached disks. And what we do is we synchronize all the transactions that are executed on the primary to the secondaries. So every transaction that is executed on the primary has some log record associated with it. And we send that log record to all of the secondaries. Those secondaries receive the log record, apply it, and then you have a copy of the database running on different SQL servers. Now, because of this, failover takes seconds. At the moment of failure, all we have to do is basically change a flag on the database and say, now this database is the copy that is online, and that is where database applications need to connect to. And from that point, we can start accepting connections. And this process takes seconds. Again, how many seconds? This can go from 10 to 20 seconds, depending on the workloads. With availability groups, we support multiple secondary replicas. So you can have different numbers. In SQL Server 2012, we support 4 secondary replicas. We'll talk about the number in SQL 2014 in a minute. And these secondaries can be active. And what this means is that you can use these secondaries, for example, to run queries. You can use them for read workloads. So if you have reporting scenarios, for example, SharePoint scenarios that require read-only access to the data, you can use your secondary replicas for that. You can also use these secondaries for backups. So taking backups is an IO-intensive operation on the primary. You can move those backups into your secondary replicas. So by doing this, you're making use of that hardware that are hosting your secondary replicas for something else than just waiting for a failover to happen. We have multiple enhancements since SQL Server 2012. So giving you some context on some of these enhancements, we supported multi-site clusters, for example, for SQL clusters. And what this allows you to do is be able to extend a SQL Server cluster across different subnets. This is very important, for example, between different data centers, where you have one main data center and your disaster recovery site, and you want to have a single cluster expanding both of them. Now you can do it without the need to stretch a virtual LAN. So a lot easier to go and configure these clusters across different data centers. We also support TempDB on the local disk. So as you know, TempDB is a temporary database that we use for many operations that require transient copies of the data. And by storing this in local disk, we improve the performance of the system. In addition, you have better utilization of your SANs because now you can dedicate your SANs to your database files and your log files, and you can use your local disk for TempDB. We also support indirect checkpoints, and this is what I was talking before about how to ensure predictable failover times. So with indirect checkpoints, what you can do is you can specify the maximum recovery time that you want to allow for a database. And based on that, SQL Server will define how often to do checkpoints. And a checkpoint basically means an event where we take dirty pages, pages that have been modified in memory, and we apply those into the physical data pages in the disk. So by doing this more often, this means that after recovery, in case of a failover, there is less work than to do. Finally, we supported flexible failover policies. And what this means is you can specify different levels of failure that will cause SQL Server to fail over. So these levels can go from 1 to 5, where 1 basically means we cannot detect that the SQL Server service is running in the machine, to level 5, where we look at things like there is a continuous out-of-memory exception, or there is some unresolved deadlock that SQL cannot resolve. In those cases, we're going to automatically fail over. So this allows you to specify different sensitivity to failures for your SQL Server. Talking about availability groups, again, this is a new solution that we introduced in previous release, SQL Server 2012. We have three characteristics of the solution. The first one is availability groups are a flexible solution. As we discussed, you have multiple database failover at the same time. Especially important people who have been using mirroring, for example, in the past, you know that you need to create a different database mirroring session for each of your databases. Now, with availability groups, you can put all of those databases in the same availability group and all of those failover together. Multiple secondaries, again, in SQL Server 2012, you can have up to 4. Maximum 2 of these can be synchronous. And basically, the difference between synchronous and asynchronous is whether or not transactions on the primary wait until those transactions are safely stored on the secondary. So if you configure it as synchronous, that means that use transactions wait until they are stored on the secondary, and that's how you can avoid any data loss. But in cases like disaster recovery scenarios where your secondaries may be in different data centers and you may have high latency between the data centers, you may want to configure these secondaries as asynchronous to avoid any performance impact on the primary. We support compression and encryption. So all the synchronization of transactions between primary and secondary is compressed, very important for bandwidth, for example, in the network. It's encrypted, important for security in large scale deployments. We support manual and automatic failover. So if you want to patch, for example, SQL Server of the operating system, you can manually fail over to a different instance, to the failover, and then eventually fail back. And that's how you can do the patching with very little downtime. You can also support automatic failover, and then SQL will automatically detect failures and failover to a different replica. Same thing as with clusters, we support flexible failover policies. So again, we have 5 levels, and you can specify this for every availability group. So if you have 5 availability groups in the same SQL Server, you can specify different flexible failover policies. So if different applications have different requirements of high availability, you can do that at the availability group level. And we have a very cool feature called automatic page repair. What it does is every time that we try to read or write a page into one of the replicas, if we detect that that page is corrupted, that replica will automatically broadcast a request for that page to all of the other replicas. And when those replicas receive the request, they'll reply back with a healthy page and will automatically, under the cover, replace the page. So this saves a lot of headache for database administrator, for example, having to deal with data corruption. Availability groups are an integrated solution. First thing, very simple for applications to connect to the primary replica. There is a single connection point. We call it the listener. It's just a DNS name. And all applications can connect to that DNS name. And that DNS name always points to the primary replica of the availability group. As usual, we try to simplify configuration. So we have a wizard of how you can configure the availability group. We have a dashboard that allows you to look at the health of the availability group. So if any replica, for example, is not able to connect to the primary, it will automatically tell you. And then you can look at some health diagnostics based on that. So it can be, for example, that the network has been disconnected, or that the primary, for example, may be actually down and there has been a failover. And at that point in time, you haven't been able to connect to the new primary. So you can get all those diagnosis information very easily through the dashboard. We integrate with System Center, so people who have large-scale environments with many SQL servers, they can use System Center to manage them. And very important, we support every feature that we have in SQL Server. So if you use things like contained databases or file stream, file table, service broker, full text, all of those features are supported in availability groups. Finally, it's an efficient solution. As I mentioned before, your secondaries are active. And what this means is you can read workloads or backups on the secondary. If you're using PowerShell, you can use PowerShell to automate any of the availability groups operations. So you can add new secondaries, you can do failover, et cetera. And finally, failover is fast, as we described before. This is a traditional deployment. So we have seen many, many customers doing similar things. So you can see on the right side, we have the main data center. And you have your primary, right? In this case, we call it AlwaysOn Server 2. And you have your local secondary for high availability. So this is configured for automatic failover. Synchronous replica, make sure that all of those transactions are replicated on both primary and secondary at the same time. And then you can have additional replicas living on another data center. So you can have, for example, AlwaysOn Server 4 living in another data center close to your data center. You may want to take backups there, for example. Many companies want to maintain backups outside of the main data center for compliance reasons. So you can do that easily now. You can also have another replica, for example, in the other side of the country for disaster recovery purposes, so that in case that there is an event that makes your primary data center unavailable, you can fail over to the disaster recovery site and continue running. In addition, you can use that disaster recovery replica for things like reporting. So if you have some reports, for example, that you need to run, you can run them there.
Okay, this is very awesome. So in a very short moment, you have run through the very comprehensive SQL Server 2012 always-on technologies. And this is awesome, right?
Yep.
So now we want to talk about SQL Server 2014. Can you tell us the enhancements?
Sure, absolutely. So let's talk about SQL Server 2014. All right, so just giving you some context into the strategy that we're following for high availability. So the first thing that we're doing is we're continuing this momentum on the enterprise. We're doing very deliberate innovations in the box product. We are introducing some new hybrid scenarios that bring all the benefit of the cloud into our on-premise customers. And then from the availability perspective, our goal is provide the best solution, the most cost-effective solution for high availability and disaster recovery for both on-premise as well as cloud solutions. And now we're introducing something called hybrid scenarios, and we'll talk a little bit more during this talk, but we have another session tomorrow just focusing completely in hybrid scenarios. So let's jump into Always On in SQL Server 2014. So we have the new enhancements here. Let's go through each of these, and then we're going to go in detail in each of these enhancements, and we have some demos for you to look at them. So the first enhancements that we do is for availability groups. First thing that we're doing is we're increasing the number of secondaries. We'll talk about that. We're increasing the availability of readable secondaries as well. So readable secondaries are those secondaries that you can use, for example, to run queries, to run reporting workloads. And finally, we are adding support to add replicas in Azure from within SQL Server. So we're really simplifying the possibility of adding replicas outside of your data center into the cloud. And we'll talk about that. In terms of SQL Server failover clusters, we're introducing a very cool new feature, which is support for Windows cluster share volumes. So we'll talk about what Windows cluster share volumes are and why it is important to support them for SQL clusters. And finally, for both availability groups as well as SQL clusters, we are supporting better diagnostics infrastructure. And we'll talk about some of the examples that we're doing here to simplify diagnosing the system. So let's talk about the first enhancement. The first enhancement is increasing the number of secondaries. So as we described in SQL 2012, we have many customers today that are already maxing out the maximum number of readable secondaries that we have. So many of our customers are already using 4 readable secondaries, and they're actually asking for more. So why is this? Well, there are a couple of reasons. The first one is many customers want to have a single solution for both high availability and scale-out read scenarios. Right? So instead of having two solutions, for example, in the past where we have transactional replication to have multiple copies for read scenarios and then database mirroring, for example, for high availability. They would like to have a single solution for this. Another good reason is the synchronization between the replicas using availability groups is many times faster than replication. And this is for many reasons. For example, replication uses logical replication, where we actually send basically the same DML and DDL statements that we run on the primary, we replicate those in the secondaries. Whereas in the case of availability groups, we have a continuous stream of log records that we're sending to the secondaries. These log records are compressed. And again, it's a continuous stream that we're sending to the secondaries. Whereas in the case of replication, for example, you have an aging job that from time to time is taking some of those transactions and sending them to the secondary. So it's a lot faster. Many customers are asking for more secondaries. One of the reasons is they have different domains. They have different offices, for example, that are part of the same company. They are in distributed environments, so some of these offices are in across the country, for example, and they want to be able to have multiple replicas that are in these offices so that they can read locally. They don't want to go and have to read, for example, on the primary or data centers close to the primary. Sometimes these data centers are very far from there, and they want to have additional copies that they can use. In other cases, they have very heavy read workloads. So some of our customers, for example, have hundreds of thousands of users running on SharePoint, and they want to be able to read from those readable secondaries in parallel. And at some point, they want to be able to scale out beyond the four secondaries. So in SQL 2014, we're increasing the number of secondaries to 8. We still maintain the number of synchronous secondaries to 2, and these are targeted to high availability. However, we have increased the total number of asynchronous secondaries. So these asynchronous secondaries will continually synchronize from the primary without having any performance impact on the primary. Now, how far behind the secondary will be compared to the primary, that will depend on the network latency between the secondaries and the I/O capabilities of the secondary. So if you have a faster disk, it will be able to redo the transactions faster than if you don't. Based on customer feedback, what we have observed is if these secondaries are within the same data center, it's less than 1 second. If this is in different data centers, it's less than 5 seconds. Now, there is minimal performance impact on adding these additional secondaries. So the first reason is, as I mentioned before, commits don't need to wait for asynchronous secondaries. The second thing is, in SQL Server, for each of these secondaries, we have a sender thread. Basically, it's a thread that is reading the transactions and sending them to the secondary. And for each of these secondaries, we have one of these threads. All of these share what we call a log pool, which is basically a cache in memory so that you don't have to read these transactions from the log in the disk. So it's a lot faster to do it from memory. If you go and add 8 asynchronous secondaries, right, to a SQL Server that today don't have any secondaries, basically the performance impact is less than 1%. So very exciting number, not to have any impact on the primary, even if you go and have 8 copies that now you can use to scale out reporting workloads. In this release, we have a scope out load balancing. That is a request that we have been getting from some customers, and we're working into that. We couldn't get it into this release. Many customers would like to have this as part of the connection string so that the connection string automatically knows that it can load balance across different replicas. Today, we have customers that do this through DNS servers, for example. So you can have a DNS server, and then you can add multiple entries to the DNS server using those readable secondaries, and then let the DNS server to run robin connections across all of them.
Could you show us how it looks like?
Sure. So let's look at the demo. We actually have a demo here. So let's look into this. So basically, what we're trying to show here is the same interface that we have today for availability groups. And we're going to show how we can extend that now from 4 secondaries into 8 secondaries. And the interface is basically the same. So what you have here is the new availability group user interface. And what you can see is we're creating an availability group here where we have the primary, right? And now we're adding multiple secondaries. So before you could have only four, now you can have up to eight, but the interface is exactly the same as before. We go and do validations for all of those secondaries, make sure, for example, that you have enough space to store your database files. And after that, you have an availability group with all those secondaries. So here basically shows, at the end of the wizard, we have a wizard that has configured eight secondaries for you. So very easy still to go and do this as before. As usual in Object Explorer, you can see all the replicas there, right? So same thing as before. You can have all your primary as well as all the secondaries running there. No changes. Very easy for you to go and change the properties of your availability group. So you can go into availability group properties. And then you can have all the availability replicas there. You can change the availability mode, for example, the failover mode, whether or not they are readable, etc. So very simple to go and do this. Nothing has changed. You still have the dashboard. And then in the dashboard, you can see, again, the health of the availability group. And the health is basically a roll-up of the health of all the replicas. So in this case, you can see that all the replicas are healthy. And because of that, the availability group is healthy. So nothing has changed from before. Exactly the same user interface, except now you can have up to eight secondaries. All right. So let's move into the next enhancement. We have increased the availability of readable secondaries. And let me talk about what that means. So in SQL Server 2012, there are certain scenarios where if you have network failures, for example, and you have a very large distributed environment where the replicas are very far between each other, those network failures can result in something that we call the replica going into resolving state. So let's say you have your primary in one part of the country, the secondary in another part. If the secondary cannot see the primary, that secondary replica goes into what we call the resolving state. And the resolving state basically means the secondary cannot connect to the primary. It doesn't know if there is a failover in progress, if it's a primary or, if there is a new primary or not. So in that state, in SQL Server 2012, we kill the active connections that are reading from that secondary. So we have a couple of customers with those very large scenarios. They wanted to make sure that those readable secondaries are available at all times. So we have done a change in SQL 14 where now, even if the secondary replicas lose connectivity to the primary, the secondary replicas will still allow readable connections to continue happening. So if you have a reporting workload, for example, that is running on that secondary, the workload will continue running without any interruption. We require direct connections to the readable secondaries. So what this means is in SQL Server 2012, we have something called read-only routing. So in your connection string, you could specify that connection strings that specify something called read-only intent are routed to a readable secondary. So that approach requires going to the primary because the primary is the one that maintains the list of readable secondaries in the system. So if you don't have access to the primary, like in this case where you have these large networks in the middle, then you cannot go and route that connection. So if you want to be able to have continuous access to that readable secondary at all times, irrespective of whether you lose connectivity with your primary, then you should connect directly to the readable secondary. And that's in general what customers do. So they connect SharePoint, for example, to that readable secondary, and they can continue running. And then even if the system loses connectivity, they will not notice that. As always, we provide you information about the system. So in the replica, we'll show you, for example, when was the last time that that replica committed a transaction. So if the secondary, for example, hasn't been able to commit a transaction in 1 minute, you'll be able to see the last time that it committed. You'll also be able to see the actual transaction sequence number that that replica committed. So you can compare that, for example, with other replicas or the primary if that is accessible. So this picture illustrates that. So again, the same deployment as before. The difference now is if you lose any connectivity between the data centers, your secondary replicas will not be impacted by that, and you can just continue reading from them.
This is awesome. You're going to show us how it runs, right?
Yeah. Okay. So let me show you that as well. So I have a couple of examples here. Let me go into that. Okay, so what we have here in the screen are two SQL servers. So on the left side, we have the primary replica. Right? This, you can see here that this is running as the primary. Right? On the right side, we have the secondary replica. Right? So what we're going to do here, actually, on the left side, we have another secondary, just to make this a little bit more interesting. So we have the primary replica running here. We have a little, another local secondary here. And then we have the readable secondary that is running in a different data center. So what we're going to do here first is, on the primary, we're going to create a table, insert some values into that table. So you can see I inserted three values. Right? On the secondary, because it's readable, I can go and read from those. So I can see the values there. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to stop the SQL Server service on the primary. Right? So let's stop it. So as it is stopped, what you will see is that we have a new primary here, right, in the system. Okay, and then in the new primary, what we can do is actually insert a couple of records, 4 and 5, for example, in that primary, and then you will see that those records are being replicated to the secondary, right? So that's exactly the same behavior as we had before. Now the new behavior is, at this point, we're going to go and stop the new primary, right? So we stop the new primary, and you can see that at this point, we don't have any primary in the system. So Object Explorer is indicating here just because it cannot connect to SQL Server, so it's not refreshing the UI, but you can see that the connection that we had opened before in SSMS has input an error at this point. So we don't have a primary in this situation. However, we can go to the secondary, and you can see that from the secondary, I can go and select. I can select the count. And you can see that I can still see all the records that I have up to that point. So your readable secondary is still available, even if you don't have any primary replicas in the system. Now, as I mentioned before, we have all the information about the secondary state. So we have here the dashboard, for example. In this graphical interface, we'll tell you that there is a problem in the availability group. We told you that the problem here is that the replica is not synchronizing. We actually show you the last commit sequence number. What was the last transaction that secondary committed? When was the last time that it committed as well? And then you look into further details, you can see here more information about it. And you can see that the secondary is not connecting to the primary replica. So you have all the information there to go and troubleshoot the issue. But in the meantime, your readable secondary workloads will continue working. At some point, your primary replica will become online again. So in this case, let's go and bring the SQL Server service again online. So we'll start it. We can go and insert a couple more records on the primary. So I'm going to insert record 6 and 7. And now what you will see on the secondary side is indicating me now that the secondary is back into synchronizing state, right? So the secondary is now being able to connect to the primary. And if I look back here to the last commit sequence number and the last commit time, basically this has been updated to the latest transactions that I have been synchronizing from the primary. So that basically shows you how you can are able to use your readable secondaries even in these conditions. So let's go back to the presentation. All right, another investment that we're doing is into enhanced diagnostics. So we're doing this for both availability groups and SQL failover cluster instances. And we have 24 enhancements that go from different places in SQL Server. Some of these are in the dashboard. Some of these are related to error messages. Some of these are related to DMBs and some to X events. And the idea is we try to simplify troubleshooting and also be proactive and prevent any issues before they even start to happen. And we define this based on feedback from customers as well as what we call the SQL Customer Support Service, CSS. So we have some feedback. And then we went and looked into those scenarios where some customers in the past have some more difficulty troubleshooting, and we tried to simplify those scenarios. So here we have a very long list. This is actually only 1/3 of the total number of enhancements that we did. So I'm not going to go into detail here. I'm just going to talk about a couple of these so that you get an idea of the things that we're doing. So, for example, one of the changes that we're doing is in Management Studio, we have something called the X7 Viewer. And that X7 Viewer is what you can use to look at the X7 session. And the X7 session basically has the list of all the events that have happened while the system is running. Right? So you have multiple events that happen, and you can go and track those through the SSMS X7 Viewer. In SQL 2012, that is presented only in local time. So the problem here is if you have a distributed scenario where some of the replicas are in different times, it's sometimes hard to correlate this. So we went and added the option to have these times in UTC. So you simplify that, for example. We warn about some configurations where the configuration may behave in a different way of how you expected it. So for example, if you configure your primary replicas asynchronous, and then you configure your secondary replicas synchronous, in some cases, customers have assumed that is a synchronous configuration, whereas that is really defined by the combination of both, and the combination will determine that this is, in fact, an asynchronous log synchronization between the two. So we warn about some of these behaviors, and we want to make sure that it's very clear how you're configuring the system. We are introducing a new system function, its primary replica. It's a Boolean function, so you can give it the name of a database, and this will return whether or not the current SQL server is the primary replica for that database. So in SQL 2012, basically you have to run a query joining a couple of DMBs. So we have simplified this even more and just have a single system function. We are outputting additional detail into the error log every time that the replicas change state. So every time that a replica goes from primary into resolving state because there is some transition in the system, or from resolving state to secondary, we output more information into error log. So we output things like, what was the last transaction sequence number that replica committed? What was the last time that replica committed? So you have all that information now available in the log. So for DBAs that are used to use the error log, for example, they can go and quickly correlate, for example, between replicas and identify the one that is closest to the primary. So it makes it easier to do this just through the log. We are separating error messages that have two or more root causes into different errors. So for example, we have an error message today about the secondary replica for some reason could not become the primary replica. And there are two potential reasons in general. It could be, for example, because the replica was not synchronized with the primary, and to avoid data loss, the replica didn't become the primary. Or it can be, for example, because you started the replica in what is called a forced quorum mode. We don't have a lot of time to go into detail, but we are basically separating those reasons into different error messages. And we're doing this for a couple more error messages. So what this means is, in case there is an error in the system, you will have exactly the reason why that happened. And we have 13 more enhancements.
That's awesome. So I love this thing because many times if things break, I don't know where to troubleshoot and all that. So now you can have this enhanced diagnostic, right, to help us do that. Can you show us how it is?
Yeah. So let me go into a couple of examples here, some of the enhancements that we have done. So let's go through a couple of these. So the first one, very simple. As I mentioned before, we have this new system function, HADR is primary replica, and this will tell you if this SQL server is a primary replica for this database. In this case, you can see that this one is not, returning a zero. In this case, you can see that this one is the primary replica. So it's very easy now if you want to identify this, for example, in an agent job, because you only want to run the agent job on the primary, all you have to do is use this function and you can define if it's the primary. Here is the other example that I talk about. So now in the X7 viewer, you have an additional column called timestamp in UTC. So if you have different SQL servers and you want to correlate the events between the SQL servers, you can just use UTC time, and then you can use a single time to correlate between them. And finally, just an example of what I was describing before. So in the new availability group wizard, if, for example, you configure certain configuration, like the primary being asynchronous and the secondary being synchronous, will warn you about the behavior of the overall configuration so that you can decide whether that's really what you want to do. So there are some examples of the enhancements that we have done for diagnostics.
This is very cool because all customers now can actually troubleshoot AlwaysOn easier.
Yeah.
With this.
Yeah. All right. So let's go and talk about SQL clusters. So for our customers who are using SQL clusters today, we're very excited. We're introducing support for Windows cluster chair volumes. And Windows cluster chair volumes, for some of you who may not be familiar with it, is basically a shared disk that is accessible to all the nodes in a cluster. And the way it's accessible is through SMB, so it follows the SMB protocol. You have a single SMB chair that all of those cluster nodes can access. One of the advantages that you have is that you can have multiple cluster chair volumes in the same physical drive. And why is this important for SQL clusters? Well, there are many reasons. One of the reasons is that it improves the utilization of the SAN. So SANs are expensive, and you want to get the most usage out of them. So today, you have a limited number of drives that you can use. This is defined basically by the letters of the alphabet. You have 24 drives. Some customers work around that limitation by using things like mount points, for example, and they mount additional drives. But over time, this basically means that you have to go and manage all of these mount points. So there is additional work that you need to do. And there is a better solution now with cluster chair volumes that Windows has to be able to manage the space in the chair storage. Another reason is with cluster chair volumes, you increase the resiliency of I/O operations. So we have an example here where you have your two cluster nodes. You have your primary, and you have your secondary node. And you have your chair storage, and then the primary is writing to the chair storage. If for some reason the primary cannot write to the chair storage because, for example, the network has a glitch, the cluster chair volume will underlying retry that write or that read across a different path through a different cluster node. So it will redirect that attempt to read or write through a different network link. And basically, from the SQL Server perspective, this becomes transparent. So you're increasing the resiliency of your shared storage just by creating this abstraction of the cluster chair volume between your SQL Server cluster and the shared storage. The final thing, this increases the resiliency of failover. So people who are familiar with SQL clusters, they know that at failover time, we need to unmount the drives from the primary node, and we need to mount those drives into the new primary node. So that unmount and mount operation in certain situations can result in failures, and because of that, the failover operation may fail itself. So with cluster chair volumes, the failover process becomes a lot simpler than that, because all the nodes have to do at this point is, after failover, be able to connect to the cluster chair volume and read from it, right? And worst case scenario, if it cannot read directly from that cluster chair volume, the request will automatically be rerouted across a different node. So it increases the resiliency of failover as well. So this is what we have in the slide. So basically, if the link goes down, the request will be tried to a different node. This is an example of how it looks like. So on the top, what you have is Failover Cluster Manager. So this is the Windows Server Failover Cluster Manager. And what you can see here are the different cluster disks. So in this case, Windows cluster, we have added 4 disks. And you can see that 2 of these disks are running as cluster chair volumes. So we configured these disks as cluster chair volumes. And now, from the SQL Server perspective, all you have to do is, when you go and install your SQL Server cluster, you can specify those cluster disks that we define as cluster chair volumes. You can use them in SQL cluster setup. And now you can use this disk to store your data and log files for your databases. And after that, everything else is transparent from the SQL Server perspective, and you get all the benefits that we discussed before. Um, besides the SQL Server, something that I wanted to mention is there are many enhancements in both Windows Server 2012 and Windows Server 2012 R2 that benefit AlwaysOn. Basically, SQL Server high availability and disaster recovery improves with some of these enhancements on Windows Server as well. A couple of examples, Windows Server 2012, there is something called dynamic quorum. And the idea here is that if for some reason one of the nodes in the cluster becomes unavailable, Windows cluster will automatically remove what is called a BYOD. And that means that it won't be considered as part of the cluster until that node comes back online. And this basically enables what is called the last man standing, where, for example, if you have three nodes in the cluster, let's say your primary and two secondaries, and one of the secondaries goes down, eventually another goes down, even at that point, you'll be able to continue running with a single primary in the system. There are increased network resiliency enhancements, so Windows Cluster manages additional exceptions in the network. This basically ensures that even if you have network glitches, Windows Cluster is able to handle them and the cluster continues unimpacted. In Windows Server 2012 R2, we have something called network names without Active Directory. So people who have used Cluster in the past, they know that if you want to create some names that you can use to connect, for example, to your SQL cluster, the action of creating the name involves going into Active Directory and creating a computer object. And basically, that requires permissions in Active Directory, and that requires avoiding any collisions with any other object that exists there. So to simplify this creation, we're actually removing the dependency in Active Directory for these names. So now you can go and create network names, for example, for SQL cluster or for your availability group without the need of Active Directory. So with that, we conclude this presentation.
Thank you so much, Luis Carlos. We have seen many new enhancements on AlwaysOn in SQL Server 2014 today, starting from increased number of secondaries.
Yep.
You have increased readable secondaries availability.
Yep.
And then you also have enhanced diagnostic and all this extra thing that you get from Windows Server 2012
Correct.
And 2012 R2. Thank you so much, guys, for attending this session. We'll take a 15-minute break. We'll be back with another exciting session on SQL Server 2014. Thank you.
Thank you.